Okay, we're going.
Okay. Right, so far then. So this is, welcome to this sociology video. This is sociology G672, OCR AS level exam, sociology of the family. We're looking at a question, identify and explain two ways in which cultural diversity affects family life in the contemporary UK, 17 marks. And we've said that cultural diversity refers to different ways of life mixing together, variations and differences in the norms and values of groups in one society. And we've said this could include subcultures, i.e. punks, according to a study by Bennett. We've said religious, same-sex, ethnic groups, social class groups can vary in terms of norms and values, status and roles in family life. And we've said in the contemporary UK, there are processes like deindustrialisation and immigration. So broadly, there are social, political, economic, and cultural changes which can affect cultural diversity and family life. Okay, we're going to look at two main ways now. So what are the two main ways we could look at? So, Madiha, what do you think could be a way of structuring it? So we've got two main ways. Right, okay, so we could use social or one of these other issues, okay, to explain it. All right. And now we mentioned the Bose study earlier. What was the Bose study?
That was the Bengalis living in Brooklyn, in East London, and they take up the vast majority of the space.
Take up the space. Right, okay.
That's true. That's true.
They're large proportion of the community. Bangladeshi. Yeah.
That's
the family.
This to do with.
In the East End of London. So adding to diversity. Okay, and that was about Brick Lane and about the kind of culture there in terms of South Asian culture and food. Okay, what have we got in terms of family life studies? So for cultural diversity.
Correct. Not Madhuda tell about the mother tongue. And how South Asian families, it decreases over time. So nowadays in the generation, they would barely speak their mother tongue.
Good, okay, so we've got South Asian families. And this is about the younger generation, and it's about the mother tongue. So less likely to speak their language. So this suggests that cultural diversity means that there's processes of code-switching. So we could say that there's these two opposing forces of West and kind of Eastern culture, perhaps.
So another one, second, is that like a start of a new paragraph? Or that
well, this could go in the same section. We need to tie it together in some kind of a structure. The structure suggested was social or political or economic or cultural issues. So we could look at one of those, or we could look at norms and values and status and roles. That somewhat relate to one of those. So we can think about how the kind of structure.
Culture.
To do with culture, so norms and values maybe. So we can talk about norms and values of ethnic groups or just cultural groups generally, and that will be even wider, which is better. So the general tip for the exam is to go from the widest possible points and then look at the specific issues. So we're going to tie it together with this widest possible point of norms and values. Then we're applying our evidence to it like this. There's a study by Singh about Sikhs. Okay, so Singh's study about Sikhs. Does anyone know what that study says?
About how they were.
Yeah, no, that's good. So it's about help. Okay, what did they say? Can you want to finish off?
They were collectivists and now they're individualists.
Right, so we're collectivists.
Could you add on, I think, is it Song or Zhang or something, about the Chinese? How they,
working class.
No, no, how they, it's about like they're working, like the restaurant and catering store business.
Right.
Majority of Chinese people like on chickpeas.
Okay, catering. Yeah. And you could say that there was a study about sacrifice, British Chinese families.
Francis and Archer.
We need to add a perspective to this side. Okay, but we're building on this side because you suggested something, so we're going there. So Francis and Archer, British Chinese families. Okay, they focus on catering. They might come from perhaps non-educated or non-academic backgrounds. However, what do they do for their children?
It's a good hard one. Francis tried a hard one. Because they sacrifice a lot so their children couldn't succeed.
Okay, good. So we've got the idea of British Chinese families. They might come from non-academic backgrounds. They make sacrifices for their children to be successful in education. So success is hard won. There's also the idea of like the tiger mum. There was a book called Tiger Mom in America. Tiger Mom. which refers to like South Asian or Asian families.
How could Tiger Mom know?
Because she's fierce in making sure that her child does the work when he or she returns home from school. Okay, so talk about fierce and strong parenting to pressure and encourage children. In the first wave of Vietnamese boat children, who came into the United States.
Some of them came from the United Kingdom.
Yeah, after the Second World War, sociologists were shocked at how successful they were in education because they had this attitude that you can achieve success regardless of your background if you try and you remain hardworking. So you've got these ideas about status. So we could say that that's status and roles. And the other side is norms and values. So to tie this together, we need some perspectives. So over here we've said norms and values of different cultural groups may vary. This is all about ethnicity. We could talk about the middle class and the working class norms and values and how they socialise their children into different values. Can anyone think of how the working class and middle class children be differently socialised? What kind of values they learn, which are different comparing middle class to working class kids? What kind of things they might learn? Go on, say it. Good. Okay, so you've got the concept of immediate gratification. So what does that mean? What does immediate gratification mean?
To get money, you want to spend it, and get pleasure straight away.
Get money, want to spend it, get pleasure straight away. So the general attitude is not planning for the future, but straight away enjoying and seeking pleasure. Whereas the working class kids may be socialised into valuing immediate gratification, so pursuit of leisure and pleasure. Middle-class children may be socialised into valuing deferred gratification. So saving for the future, putting off what they want for the future instead of enjoying it now. Okay, so the idea of career, ambition, aspiration, whereas the working class might be focused on enjoying life now. Okay. So you've got that concept, you've got the ethnic groups here for norms and values. So can you all think of a perspective for this side, the norms and values?
Functionist
meritocracy. Okay. Where could we apply that?
You're saying with the class say that we should save up for.
Okay. So we could add it here specifically for this bit here. So we could argue that society is unequal but fair, middle class and working class children are socialised differently in a meritocracy. Your abilities and your effort are reflected in your status.
The normal value is coming. What's the percent for that? I'll come use because I'm quite confused. My book.
Okay. Right. So.
Functionalist or this?
Yeah, you could use functionalist because generally they'd say culture of society is important and culture of groups is important in explaining behaviour. Okay, so you could use functionalist. Talk about socialisation. Okay, you could use the postmodernists, okay, for this side, because you could say that there is this code switching, because there's a greater degree of choice and change in family life. And change is a result of diversity. Okay, that might be enough, or that is enough. You only need one perspective for the whole essay. But it'd be good to put one in each section. You could put the new right as well to talk about the concept of a black underclass and the concern about children not receiving the right norms and values because of ethnic difference. That's another possible point as well. Then we've got status and roles. We've mentioned studies. What perspectives could we add for status and roles? And is there any data as well? I mentioned data.
Functionalist and Marxist.
Yeah.
Marxist with capitalism and only the hierarchy.
So Marxist because of capitalism. So what would they say about status and roles and difference?
Achieved and ascribed.
What would they say about achieved and ascribed status? The Marxists. Okay, well, there is a study on status and family and ethnic difference which showed that children from black African Caribbean backgrounds actually felt that their success was hard won because they were battling against the odds. It was like really bad odds because they're black. They're likely to experience prejudice, discrimination, possibly racism and stereotyping. And so they felt that if they did achieve success in education, it was against the odds. So they tried hard to achieve success, to prove the establishment wrong. That was a study to do with black African Caribbean girls. So you could say that racism interplays with family life because families are thinking they need to work hard against the odds to be successful. But it makes them more determined to push their children to be successful. With the stuff about hard-won sacrifices and success, you can still relate this to functionalist and meritocracy. You could say that this proves that with effort, anyone can achieve success because there are equal opportunities. So you could refer to the idea of equal opportunities. There's some interesting data on this, which you could apply to either side. So I'll put it in the middle and think about where you think it you want to apply it in your answer. So the data on this from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, which studies poverty, is looking at ethnic poverty. Can anyone remember what the difference was between white British males who are 25 and over in terms of unemployment? What was the statistic for unemployment compared to Pakistani and Bangladeshi males 25 and over and their percentage of unemployment?
White British males are lower.
White British males were lower, 15%, compared to 30 to 40% for Pakistani or Bangladeshi males, 25 and over. So in terms of unemployment, white British males, on average, are less likely to be unemployed compared to Pakistani and Bangladeshi males. Now, that's a statistic which, obviously, if you're looking at white British males, includes all the class groups. So it may not tell us as much as if we drilled down to each class group. Poverty is said to be more important than class is said to be more important than ethnicity and race because white British males are still the worst underachievers at GCSE. So there's another fact as well. So what do you think, where do you think you could relate this statistic? Where do you think you could put this finding?
Well,
where is it most relevant? Any ideas? Sophia, any ideas where this might be relevant? On this side or more on this kind of side about why British males are less likely to be unemployed? Ahana? You think it might be because of different norms of values? Can you just explain what you mean by that? So it could be more to do with norms and values than ability and social background in terms of class. If we say that, for example, African Caribbean girls are more successful often. So it's not to do with background, it's actually to do with norms and values. So you could use it to support the view that there's a problem with some groups. The New Right might support this, that there's a kind of black underclass. And so it might be concerned about some ethnic minority groups from some status backgrounds who are more likely to fail in education because of their culture and the difference with the education system. Whereas some groups, British Chinese families, make different choices about education and have different attitudes towards education. Other groups might have different attitudes because of culture. And that's what the New Right might argue is a controversial argument. Postmodernists would argue that you know, each group just has a different way of looking at the world, which is not necessarily better or worse. So we've covered perspectives on both sides and the data there, concepts, contemporary examples. So if you haven't got any questions, email me at daniel_butcher@hotmail.co.uk.
You've got to do a professional outro.
All right, okay. Tag me on Twitter feed in the space below.
#education.
This is Daniel Butcher signing out. Make sure you subscribe, like, comment and share. And then do a blog.
This is Daniel Butcher signing out. Make sure you share this, like it on YouTube. See you later. I love you all.
There you go. Bad buddy.